So, hi everyone. We are continuing to develop on our logistic regression model using the following data set that we have on the dependent variable admit, which takes a value 1 if the student got admitted into a graduate college after completing his undergrad course, and 0 means that he could not get admitted to a graduate college. Then there are 3 independent variables which affect this dependent variable, 2 being continuous, GRE score and GPA score, and 1 being categorical, that is the rank of the college from where the student belongs to currently. Okay, so from the college from where he did his undergraduate course, where 1 being the topmost rank college and 4 means the worst rank college. Now, for the steps of the analysis, you can watch my previous lecture video since it's a 2-part series of logistic regression. And in that particular video, I've already explained half of the output and I'm going to proceed with the latter part. So initially, our model builds upon an empty model, basically the model devoid of any independent variables, which we call as block 0 or the beginning block. And then the model adds all the independent variables and we enter the block 1, that is our full model. Okay. About this omnibus test of model coefficients, we have discussed this in the earlier video lecture. Next, we come on to this model summary. As I told you that in logistic regression models, we no longer use OLS estimation procedure to estimate your regression line. You use maximum likelihood estimation. So in maximum likelihood estimation, what happens is this. Basically, this method allows us to determine values for the parameters. So here are the parameters of our interest being, let's say, the betas of our model, so that these parameter values, these parameters are the values found such that they maximize the likelihood that the process described by the model produced the data that were actually observed. So you can think of it by comparing to OLS. So what do you do in OLS? In OLS, you try to minimize the sum of squared residuals. So basically, the residual being the difference between predicted Y and actual Y. Now, as against OLS, what we're doing in maximum likelihood estimation is that I am now increasing the likelihood that my predicted YI will be as close as possible to the actual YI. Okay, so that's the gist. So basically, how this particular estimation procedure works is honestly mathematical, but intuitively, I would like to explain you in this fashion. So the program will start with some arbitrary values of the regression coefficient, say beta, okay? So this is what I'm explaining about an iterative process of log likelihood. So what happens in iterative process? Initially, the program will start with some arbitrary values of your beta, that is your regression coefficient, and then it will construct an initial model for predicting the observed data, that is your YI. It will then evaluate the errors arising in such a prediction, and once those errors are found out, it then goes on subsequently. So it will keep on changing the regression coefficients in the second iteration, in the third iteration, and so on, till the point at which we feel that now the likelihood of the observed data are greater under this very latest or the new model. Okay. So this procedure is repeated until the likelihood function is maximized. Okay. So that is, the model converges in successive iterations. So in each iteration, you're finding some betas. Finding some betas, you have some predicted YI. And then you check how close is this to the actual data. You're going to repeat this process till the point where the differences between your predicted YIs and actual YIs are reduced to a minimum. Okay. And all of this is happening by maximizing your likelihood function. That is the probability function, okay? So basically, you're gonna repeat this process until there is negligible difference between the newest and the previous model. And therefore, you say that you have now, converged in a model, okay? Now, in this particular model, when I say that I have converged, that means, you know, the successive values on the likelihood function are very close to each other. So beyond that, I need not go. Now, that was about maximum likelihood estimation. Okay, keep that in mind. Now, in logistic regression, we are taking a logarithm of this likelihood. Okay? So in a way, so in mathematics also, and in economics, I would rather take an example of economics. Can you say that maximizing profits is just the same as minimizing cost? That's actually right, right? So basically, if maximizing profits is identical to minimizing cost, you can also understand it in this fashion, that maximizing your quote-unquote likelihood function is equivalent to minimizing your negative of log likelihood function. I repeat, maximizing of likelihood function is equivalent to saying that I am minimizing the log of likelihood function. Okay? So in the logistic regression, the iterations will go on successively till the point your negative of log likelihood is minimized. Okay? So for example, in our model, the estimation terminated at iteration number 4. Because the parameter estimates changed by less than 0.001. That means the change in this very latest model, that is at iteration 4, with respect to the iteration 3 model, was by only this size. So it changed by very little, which is why we stopped at iteration 4. And at that particular iteration, the negative log likelihood was recorded as 458.517. Okay? I explained you the entire process so you know what this log likelihood means, okay? Otherwise, for interpretation sake, you can now understand that log likelihood is nothing but a transformation of likelihood, obviously. So, if this log likelihood is negative and smaller, we say that likelihood function is getting maximized, correct? So, in a way, for example, here, I can say that the model has converged after 4 iterations, and the smaller is this value, the better is your model in predicting the decision on the outcome variable. So you should be looking and you should be vouching for a smaller negative log likelihood. Okay? So this is negative of 458.517. Now, what are these two values? Cox and Snell R square and Nagel-Kirk R square. So these are the two alternative R-square values, because obviously R-square does not make sense in a qualitative regression model, okay? So R-squares do make sense when you have a model where the dependent variable is continuous, but in case the dependent variable is not continuous, R-squares hold very little, or I should say, you know, they hold no importance rather. So interpreting R-square would be really misleading in such scenarios. Nevertheless, Cox and Snell R-square, talking about it. So this is identically equal to the conventional R-square, but it cannot reach the maximum value of 1. So it can at times be low, very lower than 1, but it won't ever exceed 1. Okay? Can't reach a maximum value of 1, basically. So it won't ever be 1 completely or greater than that. About the Nagel-Kirk R-square, it is again a proxy to look at the R-square, and it can reach a maximum value of 1. And you can see it's 0.138. Nevertheless, you don't have to bother about both of these. Usually, people happen to interpret this Cox and Snell R-square as compared to this Nagel-Kirk. But I would rather ask you to refrain from interpreting R-square in case of qualitative regression models. Then comes the Hosmer and Lemshow test. So about this test, the null hypothesis is that the prediction or the classifications made by the model fit perfectly with the observed group membership. Okay? Because you would want that your model classifies as best as possible, right? So the null hypothesis here is desirable for us. And we see that it is using a chi-square test, and the p-value is 0.197, which is way greater than any p-value, say 0.01 or 0.05. So I might as well choose to defend my null in favor of the you know, alternative. So I'm not able to reject the null hypothesis. That means the predictions made by our current model, as in this question, or the data set in question, fit perfectly with the observed group membership. Okay, then we come onto the classification table. This is identical to the confusion matrix we also came across in discriminant function analysis. So as you can see, the rows identify the observed data, columns identify the predicted data. For example, out of total people who were admitted, okay, so out of total people who were admitted, that means who had a value 1 on the dependent variable, 30 were correctly classified as admitted, okay? So basically, if you want to know how many people were there who were total admitted, you come here at log 0. So we have in 1, 127 people. So that means out of 127 people who were admitted to the college, 30 people are correctly predicted or correctly classified through our logistic regression model. That's quite a low number, I would say. So the percentage of cases correctly classified can be found out by taking 30 upon 127 into 100, that would come out to be 23.6%. Okay, so this is the percentage of correctly classified cases in category 1. Likewise for category 0, out of total, so how many were there? In total, we had, 273. So out of 273 people, 254 were correctly classified as not being admitted, that is being in category 0. That makes up 254 upon 273 into 100, a 93%. That's a fantastic number. So we see that on the 0 category, our model has made some really impressive predictions. But about the 1 category, it has fallen apart. So, you know, it's not that strong maybe. So how does the model work out with these predictions is via cutoff value. So in our data, the SPSS has taken by default a cutoff value of 0.5. That means if you come to the data where you have saved the probabilities, so these are the saved probabilities and these are the predicted groups. So you see that wherever the predicted probabilities are greater than 0.5, the person is categorized into category 1. So let's check. For example, the first one is 0.17, which is less than 0.5, that means I'll classify this student as being in category 0. Okay. Likewise, let's pick a number like 0.73, which is greater than 0.5. That means I'll classify this person in category 1. So basically, it's like a 50% chance. So if you think that the probability, that there is a predicted probability, is working out to be greater than 50%, you say that there's a high chance and classify this person in group 1. So that's how this classification table has been worked out, by taking a cut value or cutoff value of 0.5. And about the total, correctly classified cases, you can just add up these two elements. So if you add 254 and 30 and divide by 400, multiplied by 100, you'll get 71%. So that means 254 plus 30, that is 284, divided by 400 into 100 gives me a 71%. So 71% overall were correctly classified. So that was about classification table. We have done some, you know, very good tests also. Now let's come on to the main part, interpreting the logistic regression output. That is your regression equation, okay? So these are the variables in the equation now. That means you have now included all the independent variables. So how do we interpret? Recall, you are modeling log of likelihood as a linear function of the independent variables. So a regression equation is like log of odds ratio is equal to beta 1 plus beta 2 x1 plus beta 2 x2 and so on plus some error term. Okay. So in our model, first independent variable is GRE. So how do I interpret the beta and odds ratio will be important. So let's try to interpret them. So for GRE's beta, we say that for a unit change in GRE score, the log odds of admission, that is the log odds of dependent variable taking a value 1 versus
non-admission, that is a dependent variable taking a value 0, increases by 0.002. Since it is positive, I'm going to use the word increases. Okay. And these are depictive of change in log odds due to change in independent variable. Okay. So I repeat. So for every unit change in GRE, the log odds of admission versus non-admission increases by 0.002. Now, if you take exponentiated form of your log odds, you will get the odds ratio. Simple mathematics. If you have log of y is equal to x, how do you find y? You just put e to the power x. So that's what this e to the power x is. So this is exponentiated form of the log odds, which is giving you the odds ratio. Yeah. Okay. So odds ratio is the ratio of probability of the outcome happening to the probability of outcome not happening. So how do I interpret this? For a unit change in GRE score, my odds in favor of getting admitted into a graduate college increase by 1.002. Okay, so that's how you interpret the odds ratio. Now let's talk about GPA in a similar fashion. And so that means with a unit increase in GPA score, log odds of being admitted to a graduate school increases by 0.804. And about odds ratio, that would mean for a unit increase in GPA score, the odds in favor of getting admitted will increase by 2.235. Okay, so odds of getting admitted versus not getting admitted would increase by 2.235. That's a good number. And both of these are significant as well. So this is the p-value. If it is less than alpha of say 5%, then we reject the null hypothesis that these two coefficients are zero. That means both GRE and GPA are statistically significant also. Now let's come at the interpretation of a categorical independent variable. This is way interesting, trust me. So about the rank, since you know that our base category is rank 4 college, and rank 1 means the topmost high ranked college, and likewise 4 means the bottommost one, okay? So in case of categorical independent variables, since these are treated as dummy variables, interpretations are always made in comparison to the base category. Now here the base category is rank 4 college. So I will say that, now listen carefully to the interpretation. Having attended a college, a rank 1 college in undergrad versus an institution with rank 4. So I'm comparing rank 1 with the reference category rank 4. So having attended a rank 1 undergrad college versus an institution with rank 4, the log odds of getting admitted in the college would increase by 1.551. And it is statistically significant. P-value is nearly zero. And now coming on to the odds ratio, that would mean odds of getting admitted into a college are 4.71 times higher for students coming from rank 1 college than the students who come from rank 4 college. Okay, so likewise you can make interpretations for rank 2 and rank 3 as well. So that was about our model, and we see that rank 3 is insignificant. Okay, however rank 1 and rank 2 are statistically significant. Now that was all about our logistic regression model, and I shall end my lecture here. Thank you.